Hi everyone, I'm going to talk to you today about the subject that I've kind of been dreading a bit now, and it's about my mother. And I know I can hear some of you shouting at me now. She doesn't deserve the word mother or that title, but of course I think, I don't know, I just can't seem to switch, and I suppose I still try and show respect. But anyhow, I'll start at the beginning. My mother knew about the abuse, and I remembered her lifting me out of bed and putting me into bed with my father. And I remember the name calling. She was always calling me your daddy's whore, and she was very violent, my mother was, and she'd have really strong nails, and she would scrum the arm off me, or she'd pull the hair out of me and hit me with weapons. But she had also had a very nasty, jealous, very evil streak in her. There was never, ever any sort of love in our family, never a show of love, never telling us that we're loved or anything like that. And my mom and dad were like that again with each other as well. She used to say such vile things, and he said it back to her. And she always knew that when she brought up the rapes by my father, she'd always knew that I would shy away and cower away and not answer back. I wasn't a child who was brazen. I was shy and quiet. And that went all the way through till I was about 16. And my mother had left the country with my brothers and sisters. I've mentioned that in other videos. And she left me with my father. She just refused to take me. So I was moved into the bed full time. In that few months that she was gone before my father and I followed her over, there was never asking for me, never ringing me to see how I was or anything. It was just nothing there. So when I did move to England, and I was trying to stop the abuse, my mother was getting kind of more violent, and so was my father. But one day I saw like a little shadow of kindness, a little light there, and she let me out of the room. My father had locked me in that day to stop me going to college, and she told me to go to social services. And that's what I did. And when they came and questioned my mother and father, she lied, and she told them I was out of control, and I was constantly causing trouble in her marriage. So I kind of always knew not to trust her, and the times I had let that cover slip, and I did trust her, it always backfired on me. My mother would have a was like a law in the house where every night when we were going to bed, I wasn't allowed to wear my underwear in bed. And my underwear, I had to take my pants off and go and wash them in the sink before I put them in the wash. And that little ritual confused me for years. And I do believe it was because she didn't want to see any sign of the abuse I was going through. You can imagine, you can imagine what she was on about. So when I ran away when I was 17, I ran away with the first guy who showed me a little bit of attention and got pregnant very quick. And I went back to tell my parents I was pregnant, and there was nothing really from my mother up until I had the baby. I remember her being at the hospital the night I had my baby, and I'd had an awful birth, and they had done a vacuum extraction, and I was crying because they then told me that my baby was born with no fingers in one hand. And the nurses went out to bring my mother in. And I guess this was because, you know, mothers will look after their daughters and everything. And my mum came in and I was crying and I says, I can do nothing right. Can't even have a baby right. Now, she wasn't nasty to me, but she wasn't overly nice either. And then it was within a week or so, she started then telling me that I wasn't being a good mother and I wasn't able to cope and what life was I going to give my baby. But what I didn't realise was it was all a form of manipulation. She was after my baby. She wanted my baby. And that's what she got in the end. That's what she just took. And with no regard to anything that it did to me. So that went on for a few years. Like she was so bitchy. Like there was never nobody was ever allowed to say that I was the baby's mother. Nobody was ever allowed to say you're like your mother. She worked on causing a rift between me and my baby for a long time. She'd never have anything nice to say. And I think at the time she even told my baby that I didn't want her and that I had done nasty things and that's why she was born the way she was born. So when I heard all this back, like I had to just take it and swallow it because I didn't want to not be able to see my baby. I needed to be around, I needed to watch her grow up. And as she did grow up, things got worse. I remember one time when I was pregnant on my third child, my mother tried to push me downstairs. We were having an argument over her mothering skills, I guess. We were arguing over my brother, and my brother had run away, and my mother just didn't care. Like, she didn't go out looking for him. And I was concerned. So that was the rocky relationship I had with my mother for years. And then when my father was questioned for the second time over the rape and abuse of me, she defended him. She denied she knew anything and told the police that there was no way there was any truth to any of it. And it was when she herself was questioned, I ended up getting an investigation against her because I knew she knew. And I just couldn't get people to believe me. I couldn't get people to understand that this is what her mother would do to her daughter. And I wrote to the police commissioner, Noreen O'Sullivan, and I asked her, I said, please, can you take a case against my mother? I know she knew. So I was actually nearly 2 years after my father's case, that the police did get in touch with me and said, we're going to investigate your mother. Well, I couldn't believe it. And then I had to endure the fact that my brother and sister were protecting her. And I don't know why, because I was never around. Like from the day my father was locked up, nobody ever was in touch with me. And especially not my baby that she took. I thought, like a lot of victims out there, when the truth comes out, that those that walked away from you would come back and say we're sorry, but of course they don't. They never do. They will never accept that they were wrong. So my mother was investigated, and it was during that investigation that we found files held in a government-run agency, and it was my proof. It was the proof I needed that she knew. She said it back in, I think it was 1983 or 84. She had actually said that she caught my father in the bed with me. And I think that then put everything to perspective for me. So I knew then that was the reason why she left to go to England. She was saving her own skin and left me, you know, to be eaten by the wolves. But when her investigation was going on, she was like poison. You know, she poisoned my brother, my sister, my nieces, my nephews. She poisoned everybody she could possibly talk to, and she made people believe that she was innocent. And it was, it'd be 2 years ago, that it was just after the Christmas, and I got a call to say that my mother was dying. And years ago, before all this happened, or I suppose around my father's case, I always thought that when my mother would be on her deathbed, that she would ask for me, and she would actually say sorry. But in the end, she got the ultimate revenge. She died a week before the DPP were to give their decision. And she died with my baby and my grandchildren around her. And that was like saying, I've won. I got what I wanted in the end. It's me they're sitting around, not you. And I also had to look at it. That was how nasty she was. That was the level that her nastiness went. And when I got the call to say she died, it was in the middle of the night. It was from my sister Laura, who I did have a good relationship with. And she rang to say, Fiona, Mum's died. And I cried. I cried for, I think it was about 2 o'clock in the morning. I got out of bed and I came downstairs and I sat here, this room, and I just thought about my mum and I cried. But the next day I stopped, the next morning, and I had to just remember the evilness that was in her. I then got a message to say I wasn't allowed to go to the funeral. I found that pretty hard because I knew I needed to go to the funeral for closure. And a message was sent that I wasn't to go. And normally I wouldn't be told what to do. And the reason I didn't go was because I had a feeling that my baby that she took, that her head was turned that much, that there's a chance that she could turn nasty and it'll end up in fisticuffs, I suppose. And there was no way I was going to get into a fight, a fight with my own child over her. So I stayed away and I did what I thought was the right thing to do. But it wasn't for her and it wasn't for me. And I respected their decision. And now she's gone. And for me and for everybody else, I think we're all left picking up the pieces and trying to get on with our lives with no closure for me anyway. And the final fingers up to who she was and the type of person she was, and that was her fingers up at me. The police never got her into court, and she should have been. That's the one thing I regret. My mother should have been in court, and she should have been in prison. And for all of you out there that hear stories of mothers that help in the rape and abuse of their child, it's true. Don't ever think that it's not true or it can't happen, that a mother's instinct is to protect. There is those mothers out there that won't protect their children and that will give up their children to stop, I don't know, stop her being asked for sex or whatever. But that's what she did. So, as I said before, any questions, Please ask me questions and I'll try and answer them as best I could. Talk to you again.